when the hungry are fed, the naked are clothed, and children living on the street are given a home, when believers truly practice what we pray, then the world will be transformed. When the lonely are loved, the frightened are freed, and women everywhere are treated equally, when believers truly practice what we pray, then the kingdom of God will be near. It's not up to God alone to listen to prayer. It's not up to God alone to answer. But when the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed. When the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed. When the nations at war put down all their arms, and troops in every country can't return to their homes, when our politics embody what we pray, then the world will be transformed. When respect for the earth is greater than greed, and human laws reflect creation's dignity, when believers truly practice what we pray, then the kingdom of God will be near. It's not up to God alone to listen to prayer. It's not up to God alone to answer. But when the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed. When the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed. When religion is true to God's living word, and preaches love and mercy over other concerns, when the churches truly practice what we preach, then the world will be transformed. When our tolerance grows beyond all our fears, and we view one another as the image of God, when believers truly practice what we pray, then the kingdom of God will be near. It's not up to God alone to listen to prayer. It's not up to God alone to answer. But when the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed. When the people of God become what we pray, the kingdom of God is revealed.
Thanks for that, Dan and Becky. Our prelude song, as my understanding, that was a song written for St. James by Marcianda. Marchanda, yeah, at a parish mission, one Lent some years ago. And so it's has a lot of meaning for a lot of people here who've been around. So welcome to our Mass. I'm glad we can all pray together today again. News rocks the world. Our president is sick and helicoptered away to a hospital. And we hope he has a mild case of this, but just a lot of not knowing. And I know it's rattled a lot of hearts and minds. And so we keep our country, our president, everyone who's sick in our prayers today. And again, root ourselves in what is good, true, and beautiful, and everlasting, and what is always our only hope and our sustenance, our daily bread, which is the love of God in our lives and our ability to respond as God's people. That's what grounds us in a world of change and concern. Okay, so we got Dan and Becky, we got Steve is reading for us, the great voice, and Landon and Don behind the camera, so let's pray.
Mm-hmm.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people. Light for the world to see. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church, gather today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light. Shine in your church, gather today.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the community of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Thank you. Let's ask for God's mercy to ground our lives. Lord Jesus, again we turn to you for love, for mercy, for confidence that you are there to renew our hearts and minds. Inflame in us a desire to be your people, healed by your mercy and called forth to act with courage and love. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, heavenly King, O God. Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer.
Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who in the abundance of your kindness surpass the merits and desires of all those who entreat you, pour out your mercy upon us to pardon what conscience dreads and to give what prayer does not dare to ask. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Let me now sing of my friend's song concerning his vineyard. My friend had a vineyard on a fertile hillside. He spaded it, cleared it of stones, and planted the choicest vines. Within it he built a watchtower and hewed out a wine press. Then he looked for the crop of grapes, but what it yielded was wild grapes. Now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there for me to do that I had not done? Why, when I looked for the crop of grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? Now I will let you know what I mean to do with my vineyard. Take away its hedge, give it to grazing, break through its wall, let it be trampled. Yes, I will make it a ruin. It shall not be pruned or hoed, but overgrown with thorns and briars. I will command the clouds not to send rain upon it. The vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his cherished plant. He looked for judgment, but see, bloodshed. The word of the Lord.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times, his praise ever in my mouth. Glory in the Lord forever, and the lowly will hear and be glad. See the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord. Glory in the Lord with me. Let us together extol his name. I sought the of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, have no anxiety at all, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. Then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is gracious, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing what you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. Then the God of peace will be with you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Hear another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a hedge around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went on a journey. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to obtain his produce. But the tenants seized the servants, and one they beat, another they killed, and a third they stoned. Again, he sent other servants, more numerous than the first ones, but they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, thinking, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to one another, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and acquire his inheritance.' They seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now, what will the owner of the vineyard do to those tenants when he comes?" They answered him, "He will put those wretched men to a wretched death and lease his vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the proper times." Jesus said to them, "Did you never read in the scriptures? 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes.' Therefore, I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will produce its fruit." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Hey. We just had a little clerical error on the first reading. It's one of my favorite lines, so I noticed that, you know, they looked for justice, but hark, the outcry. It's the people, not Jesus, in this parable that he tells today. He's referring to clear reference to that first reading in Isaiah, where people that are supposed to take care of the owner's vineyard are doing an awful job. There's another parable I heard once, not biblical, that I always kind of shed a little light on this for me. So it's about the water of life that longed to give itself to people. And it bubbled up on a spring on the earth, and it flowed freely and without limit. And people came and drank and were refreshed and were nourished. But it wasn't long before people kind of wanted to control the water of life. And they put a fence on it, you know, around it, just to protect it. And then that fence became a gate, and they started to charge admission. And some bought the property around it, claimed it as theirs, and decided who could come in and who could go out. And that made the water of life upset. And so the water of life stopped flowing there. And it moved on and bubbled up somewhere else. But, you know, the people of that first place where they had their gates and their locks and didn't even notice that the water of life was gone. They were so involved with their own power systems and projects. A couple more sensitive souls noticed and looked elsewhere, in the spirit of adventure and courage, and found the water of life that flowed freely without limit and refreshed and gave nourishment. But it wasn't long before they built a fence and bought the property and put a gate on with a lock. And so it has been since the beginning of time. We can mess things up that God intends. I think the historical context for the parable that we heard today was the tension between the Jewish leaders and Jesus, where as the century went on and when the Gospels were written, Jewish. Can you be Jewish and say that Jesus is the Messiah? You know, they got to be this big tension between those Jews like Jesus and Peter and Andrew and Thomas and all those who were Jewish, who claimed Jesus was Messiah, and those who did not. And I think a parable like this was sometimes used to make the case that the waters of life that once had flowed into the Jewish religion, and they were the chosen people, and the covenant of God had dried up, and were now part of a new church, the Christians. So when Jesus says, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will bear its fruit. And what I like about that water parable is, you know, the people that bear its fruit have it for a little while, and then they put up a fence and charge admission and mess it up. Both Judaism and Christianity hold this wonderful truth and have this great source of life flowing from it for people, and we can both distort it, you know, and mess it up. I would like to say, even though there's a lot of tension in that first century between Jews and Christians and through the years, the Second Vatican Council has, in a very beautiful way, affirmed the Jewish religion and the Jewish people as as you know, the first covenant people and still the chosen people of God, whom we respect and love and honor. So those hostile days have really no place in our church today, even though we see, unfortunately, anti-Semitism crop up in our world, other forms of racism, as we know. Anyway, but this parable still has this deep truth, even pulled out of that historical context. I was thinking in my life, you know, can the water of life, dry up in us? I was thinking in my life, I was very, I would say really fortunate to be richly rewarded as a young adult with experiences of closeness to God. It's probably why I stand here today. It just seemed like when I'd try a new way to pray or I'd read something, it would just inspire my heart and lift me. And I had a real intensive look at like, well, what does God want me to do? Am I following God's will? And in the big picture, like, what should I do with my life? But also in the little picture, what should I do today for God? Say I was drinking fully from the waters of life. You know? Then I would say there's a period in my life where almost unnoticeably I kind of just sort of rested on that strong resume from the past. Maybe wasn't praying as intensely, maybe wasn't as engaged or pushing myself to stretch, but remembering that I was close to God, and that made me feel close to God. But over time, and one night I remember praying, over time it just lessened, you know? That sense of intimacy, that intense journey, and wasn't really doing anything wrong. I guess I just wasn't trying as hard. Not as a choice, but I just kind of, you know, I don't know if you're like that or not, but you kind of, we like comfort, we like security, we like what's predictable, you know. I remember praying once, and I just had this kind of empty feeling, because before, you know, I could just light a candle and sit, and I would just feel like I'm a beloved son of God. I know that you're beloved sons of God, beloved daughter of God. I didn't think I was anything more special than any of you, but I could claim that identity. I'm a beloved son of God. And then in this other period where I was just kind of resting on my laurels or just not as in, you know, I remember praying and just feeling that emptiness, and I was scared by it. I was frightened by it. And the words that came out were, aren't I your beloved son anymore? Aren't I your beloved son anymore? In terms of this parable, has the kingdom of God been taken from me? Gone somewhere else? And I'm glad, I love in the scriptures so many times. It's just the mercy and the forgiveness and calling us back. And it just became clear to me, well, you gotta step up your game, Thomas. you gotta get praying again. You gotta ask every day. You gotta review your day. How have I been following God? How have I been doing? And if you've sinned, you ask for forgiveness. All these basic things that I'd kind of lost track of, you know. And it's important to note that my efforts didn't make God love me again. God always loves us the same, you know. But it opened my heart to receive that love again. Thank you, God, for helping me realize again a beloved son of you. It's true for us as individuals, that kind of narrative, that kind of story. I think it's true for us in a probably, I'm not a married guy, but I bet you it's true in marriages, family life, you know? You can perhaps look back and say, yeah, well, we had these great times. We were really honest with each other. We were really vulnerable with each other. We struggled. We forgave one another, you know, when we hurt each other. And, you know, we were really... And sometimes over the years, some of that effort stops. And you get kind of used to going on autopilot. Or life just gets really busy. And you're doing the things you need to do with children and all those things. But maybe the water of life in your marriage and your love dries up. It's the same thing as individuals. We renew, we recommit, we say, I want to bear fruit with you. I want to be close to you. How can we do that again? Caring for one another, acts of love, honesty, forgiveness, mercy, to reclaim it and to practice it, right? And then we realize that the waters of life are flowing again. What is most important to us, a relationship with God and with each other. I guess the moral of the stories today are that, you know, it's not just enough to say we were really good workers in the vineyard if we're not putting grapes on the table today. So let's rise and bring our faith to bear as we profess our Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Now, confident in God's care for us that never ceases and God's ability to help us, we turn to God with our needs.
For the church, that we may be made worthy of producing good fruit to build up the kingdom of God, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those living in regions of the world marked by ongoing hostilities and resentments, that they may find in their hearts a way to reconciliation, acceptance, and peace, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may foster and encourage a true and lasting respect for all human life, especially for the most vulnerable and those at the peripheries, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who harvest in fields and on farms, in orchards and vineyards, that they may be paid a just wage and treated humanely, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a fast recovery for our President and First Lady and all who have COVID, may we all care for one another by following precautions, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For respect and appreciation for all of God's creation, in the spirit of St. Francis of Assisi and Respect for Life Month, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our RCIA candidates and religious ed students who begin classes this month, may they be open to growing in faith and supported by our faith community, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intention of this Mass, Francis Kohler, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those sick in the hospitals and all in nursing and memory care homes, in hospice care, homebound, assisted living, as well as those on our prayer tree and intercession book, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. Let's each make a prayer in our hearts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, you hear us. Please grant our requests through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Okay, I'll prepare the altar for our Eucharist.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life.
Let's rise and pray, brothers, sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Amen. Accept, O Lord, we pray, the sacrifices instituted by your commands, and through the sacred mysteries which we celebrate with dutiful service, graciously complete the sanctifying work by which you are pleased to redeem us, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, creator of the world and source of all life. For you never forsake the works of your wisdom, but by your providence are even now at work in our midst. With mighty hand and outstretched arm, you led your people Israel through the desert. Now, as your church makes our pilgrim journey in the world, you always accompany us by the power of your Holy Spirit and lead us along the paths of time to the eternal joy of your kingdom through Christ. And so, with the angels and saints, we too sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God. You who love the human race, you who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for his disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask you to send forth your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, Jesus took bread and he gave you thanks. He broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on your church's offering and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. And so, having called us to your table, Lord, confirm us in unity so that together with Francis, our Pope, and William, our Bishop, and with your entire people, as we walk your ways with faith and hope, we may strive to bring joy and trust into the world. And remember our brothers and sisters who've fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. And grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Mother Mary, with Joseph, her spouse, with all the apostles, the martyrs, with St. James and all the saints. We shall exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Continue our prayer by saying together the one that Jesus taught his followers. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a sign of Christ's peace here in this church and in your homes. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us everlasting life.
Survive on others in our human greed. You about our love.
Such a beautiful song. It's may we who eat be bread for others. It's a very important sentiment, I think. So we pray our spiritual communion prayer for those who are in your homes praying and can't be by the altar. Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most blessed sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Let us pray. Grant us, Almighty God, that we may be refreshed and nourished by the sacrament which we have received, so as to be transformed into what we consume. Through Christ our Lord. Well, thanks for the beautiful music, Becky, Dan, and the strong proclamation, and our making it all possible for our people. So, the Lord be with all of you.
With your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May the Lord Jesus, who loves you, walk ahead of you to guide you. May he be at your side to give you strength. And may he be behind you should you fall. Almighty God, bless you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Take the word and go out to every land. Shine the light of Christ for all to see. Justice to the world. take the word to the nations everywhere. Shine the light of Christ for all to see.